AI was a big part of me loving basketball.
He just had that swag every time he stepped on the floor, like he was the best player on the court.
Growing up, that's definitely somebody I idolized. That was my favorite player.
Iverson, yes!
You know, AI is, you know, one of the best guards to play this game.
He was a small guard that just did it his way.
He is the man!
Me growing up, AI is everything.
Ask you is, can the story of basketball be told without Allen Iverson?
No. No. I'm a product of Michael Jordan, Isaiah Thomas, Magic Johnson, Charles Barkley, Shaquille O'Neal, all of the guys that paved the way for us, man.
A 6 foot guard out of Georgetown.
You're talking about a 6 foot, stretching it, 165-pound phenom.
Go, baby, knock out Mike Tyson style.
He was the guy everybody talked about growing up. He led a revolution.
I see a lot of guys that are small in stature wearing number 3, and I know that's why they're wearing it.
His game transcends, and a lot of guys try to be like him in so many ways.
And this kid's an incredible talent. He was an assassin with the basketball.
A lot of people try to put people in the boxes. He's a point guard. Back then,
I'm a killer. I'm a two guard. I was a killer.
You're two guard in a point guard body.
I guess if you go by size.
Right, but you felt you didn't go by size.
Nah, I was just a dude that would do anything to win.
Honestly, my first impression of him was, man, this guy's small. He kind of played bigger than his size.
He didn't fit in the NBA. He's too small, he's too skinny. Hey, the boy was rookie of the year, he was MVP. You know, he did everything.
He's a small guy that dominated a league that quote unquote supposed to be dominated by bigger guys.
He's strong, no!
He didn't back down. I don't care if it was Shaquille O'Neal, Stephon Marbury, Ray Allen. He was ready to take a challenge. Michael Jordan. He was fearless.
A big house expected in the big house tonight. 76ers and the Chicago Bulls, a special night.
I was there when he crossed up MJ. Everybody was waiting for that matchup the whole night.
Iverson has Jordan. The crowd is into it. Allen shakes free, gets two! Mike said no. Allen said yes. The bucket, the crowd loves it.
And everybody just freaked out.
He crossed over Jordan. Oh, my God.
I'd have to say, after winning the lottery, him making that shot took the hopes and expectations of the Philadelphia sports fans each time, ratcheted up one more. So you saw, maybe the team wasn't good at the time, but we had a star in which we could put the burden of the franchise on, because that move against the best player on the planet, Michael Jordan,
the love of AI in the city of Philadelphia. Talk about that for a minute, and then
man,
the next step was...
You have no idea. But go ahead.
I want you to hit that. And you go ahead and tell me about that, because it was different when I got a chance to see the way you interacted and the love of AI in the city of Philadelphia.
It's like no other.
AI has it going on!
The only thing I can compare it to is the love that the fans share with Mike in Chicago.
Allen Iverson.
Why? He's a man.
He's the best.
It don't get no better than me in Philly.
Like, Allen fit right into the city. Like, he's from Philly as far as we can say.
Not a tough town if you fully submerge yourself into Philadelphia. And that's what Allen did. I mean, you would see him, you know, around town. And that's why I think Philadelphia, they want to see their pro athletes being one of them.
We loved him from the start, from the beginning. When he came out of Georgetown, we knew there was something special about him.
Raw lightning. Wait till you see him play.
What a nifty play by Iverson. Now,
Iverson to the bucket. Now this is going to be something.
He just represented what the city was about. And I guess what the city's always been about.
My entire 8 years there, they treated me great. And years later, when Allen came, that guy gives maximum effort. If you play with maximum effort in Philly, they're gonna love you.
When you look at sports organizations in the past from Philadelphia, from the Broad Street Bullies and the Flyers to, you know, the Eagles back in 92 with the defense with, you know, Reggie White and Jerome Brown and all those guys, we've always been known as a tough town. And Allen represented that mentality, that Philly mentality. We tough and we go hard.
Every time I come in this gym, in this arena, I hear my favorite song. You know, y'all voices. So it's time for y'all to play that song. Let's make this noise and get this party jumping.
Iverson to the floor, to the hoop.
Allen had a symbiotic relationship with the crowd in Philadelphia. To this day, he still has that love. When Iverson was rolling here at the center, what did he do? He went over and he put his hand to his ear, and he went over across from the Sixers bench to that crowd and wanted the feedback.
The little guy, the MVP, trots to the sideline, asking from the fans, hurry, hurry up!
That is one of my favorite moments, because I know we're winning. I know the place is abuzz.
There are very few things when you can get 20,000 people in the palm of your hand. They were showing the love for what he was doing performance-wise, like unbelievable basketball feats, and they were pouring it back, and he loved that. That, I think, is one of the everlasting images for Iverson here in Philadelphia.
We sitting here, I'm supposed to be the franchise player, and we're in here talking about practice. I mean, listen, we talking about practice. Not a game. We talking about practice.
I remember where I was because I saw it on the news and I happened to turn on Comcast Sportsnet to see it live. I'm like, get him off! Get him off the dais!
Not a game. Not the game that I go out there and die for and play every game like it's my last.
Basically, you know, you lose your last game, you're trying to get better. I said Allen had to do things a little bit differently, and he's heard that from me so many times. He was just tired of answering the same old question, and that was his reaction, but that didn't define Allen Iverson.
Not the game. We're talking about practice, man. I mean, how silly is that? I mean, we're talking about practice.
You know, everybody goes talks about Allen Iverson practice rant. I'm pretty sure he wasn't practicing well when they were making it to the finals. But when you lose, that's the double standard. You get free reign when you're a great player and your team is on top. But when your team is losing, you're gonna get criticized. That's just the way it is.
The worst part about being in the NBA is a dude like me dealing with the media. Mm-hmm. And when you feel like you're the villain and they just effing with you all the time. The world called me the MVP. You talking about getting rid of the MVP for? It used to bother me, man. You know what I mean? Like, when you know somebody is just trying to irritate you. You know what I mean? And you feel it in your heart.
When we talk about practice, I have to laugh about that, because the happiest days of my life is when he didn't practice.
That little guy came to work every damn day and played hard. You know, and we'll go through, oh, we're talking about practice. I mean, total lie in terms of how that was interpreted. It's funny, I laugh when I hear it. I say it too.
But when it came time to win a game, or when he stepped between the lines, for a coach to know somebody's gonna give you his very best every minute of every game, that's an unbelievable feeling to have.
He was a player that, a polarizing figure where people loved him, people didn't like him. He was the fodder for talk radio. At a certain point, I think Billy King and the Sixers realized it was time to move on.
I mean, I'm the franchise player here. You know, I don't know any franchise players that come off the bench. I don't know any Olympian that come off the bench. I don't know any All-Star come off the bench. I don't know any former MVP that come off the bench. I don't know any three-time scoring champion
come off the bench. I mean, I don't know any first team or NBA come off the bench. Why Allen Iverson? Why should I come off the bench?
There comes a time, you know, there's only a few select players that are able to play their career with one franchise. And for Allen, it just didn't work out that way.
How hard was that when leaving Philly, changing teams?
I wish it never happened. But it was time because of what I wanted, you know, as far as giving the city. Like, if you're not gonna do what I think needs to be done to help us all, I'd rather be gone. You know what I mean? And I wish I would have just stuck in there and not left. You know, I wish I wouldn't have left.
At the time, you make a decision and thought it was best for him and for the organization. I thought it would give him a chance to go and win with the team that was trying to win now. And we were at a team that was adding some youth and sort of rebuilding. And so I thought at the time it was the right decision. And looking back on it, probably still is.
What's up? Finally made it. Denver, where I belong.
Iverson to Melo, alley-oop.
That's all I wanted to be is welcomed. And just give the Denver Nuggets everything that I've been giving the Sixers for 10 years.
Denver, Detroit.
Detroit was
my hometown.
Bad situation for me, Steve.
Why?
Because I was told something and I was promised something that wasn't to be.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what the conversation was between him and Detroit, but I knew Allen Iverson didn't come to Detroit to come off the bench. Same thing with me. I didn't expect when Allen Iverson came that they were will be asking me to come off the bench. Because the way it was sold was like, hey, you two guys are going to be playing together and we'll figure out how it will work.
You know, because that's the one thing. Even when they were successful in Philadelphia, it was kind of his ball. And everybody else kind of just did their thing, but that doesn't work on a lot of teams.
And I think we both kind of got caught in a situation where, from a management standpoint, they were telling us, hey, you know what? We can play together. And we knew we could play together because we talked every day. We sat right next to each other on the bus, and we knew that we could figure it out. But I just don't think that management gave it time.
I had already knew that it was going to be a problem once I got there and I couldn't have my number. So I already knew, like, yo, this ain't right off top.
Well, I think first and foremost, when Chauncey got traded, a lot of people didn't want to accept it. Me too. I didn't want to accept it at the beginning. Not the simple fact that he was traded for Allen Iverson, but the simple fact that he was traded. So when Allen came in, it's like, all right, you know what? He still wore the number one jersey. Chauncey wore the one jersey too. So a lot of people couldn't really get over that.
Then Memphis. Short stay.
I was going through too much in my life. You know what I mean? I was going through a divorce and my daughter was sick. I wasn't able to give them the Allen Iverson that they wanted.
You know, I think the way he played and kind of his mindset, you know, both led to the way his career ended. You know, could have it lasted longer? Yes. Could he have compromised in some ways to, you know, either be a scorer off the bench for somebody, be more of a facilitator? In a vacuum, sure. But I just don't think Iverson was wired that way.
I think that motivation, that inner drive that made him who he was, and the exceptional player and athlete that he was, he wasn't able to dial that back in the later years when his physical skills began to erode a little bit. And everybody has to accept a different role. You have to be flexible. And I think that probably was a tough transition for him.
After carefully weighing my options with Coach Thompson and my family, I decided to enter the NBA draft. I definitely plan to further my education, but my family needs to be addressed right now.
I saw the tape, and you saw a warrior mentality, and I love warriors. And at the time, we were looking at Allen Iverson, Stephon Marbury, Marcus Camby. But AI's workout was pretty intense. And I saw this kid have a dream and bring it to fruition.
With the first pick in the 1996 NBA draft, the Philadelphia 76ers select Allen Iverson from Georgetown University.
Even as the number one pick in the draft, and you say, like, hey, right there, like, you're done. You've made it. You know, you made it through all this. But I don't think it even stopped there. You know, I think he was the first point guard drafted overall since Magic.
You know, I've been through a lot of obstacles in my life, and, you know, I'm just happy I overcame. Now it's just time to get in the NBA, walk that straight path.
You drafted into the NBA, everybody's dream. What was it like getting prepared to play at this level? And at that time, the league was at an all-time high.
For me, it was easy.
Give me easy as a preparation or easy playing?
Both. It was easy because it was one-on-one. One-on-one basketball, I felt like, and I know that nobody can stop me one-on-one.
It's time to get down.
Iverson in a hurry, Douglas backpedaling, forget it. A stunning NBA debut with 30 points. Allen Iverson starting to heat up here.
Now the world knows what we in Philadelphia have known, that Allen Iverson is one of the most exciting, most dynamic, most fearless players in the NBA. And it gives me great pleasure on behalf of the Philadelphia 76ers to present our rookie, Allen Iverson, with the NBA Rookie of the Year Award. Yeah!
Larry Brown, one of the best teachers they've ever had. And maybe the most important acquisition they made last summer was Larry Brown as their head coach.
When I got him in Philly, the biggest change for me was I wanted him to go from being a point guard in his mind to being a scoring guard.
And it's Iverson, one-man highlight film.
Larry Brown, in his coaching history, had taken guys who had been playing the point and said, no, you know what, he's a two. And that's what he did with Iverson. He's a scorer. Just because he's 6 feet tall does not make him a point guard.
You know, and you look at the NBA now, and those definitions aren't really as defined as they were back then.
Jackson with him. Iverson makes a tough play.
You know, with him and Snow, and then him and Aaron McKee, who could guard, you know, three positions. And that was the uniqueness of our team. We had three or four guys that could guard two or three positions. You know, it allowed Allen to be himself.
You know, it took me a while to learn how to allow Allen to be Allen.
We don't wait. We're not waiting.
I was not trying to wait. I was not waiting. I didn't know where the screen was at.
And a lot of the things that he did that frustrated me, I realized it was a young kid trying to find himself.
You played for Coach Larry Brown. Play the right way. I played for Larry in Olympic.
Greatest coach ever.
Why?
Because he's just the best. When you're a basketball player and you know the game and you understand the game, and when you learn to get better, you have to recognize people like that. Like, he just know it, bro. You know what I mean? He's just great, X and O's. And even outside of that, like, you know, he just know what he's doing.
I think God put me here to coach Allen Iverson. And I look at that as an honor. And at the time I was coaching him, I don't know if I would have said that.
The only regret that I have as an athlete is not buying into what he was selling earlier in my career.
What was he selling? What was he wanting you? What was he wanting?
He was preparing me to be the MVP.
and I didn't get it because of whatever reason. I always loved him. I always care about him. But for whatever reason, I wasn't buying into it. And that's the only thing that I regret in my career.
I'm tired of everybody talking about my relationship with Allen Iverson. I wonder what your relationship would be with any employee that you might have who doesn't choose to come to work on time or doesn't choose to come to work at all.
Yeah, I was late for practice, but believe me, the times that I heard the stuff, I mean, nobody would put up with that. I mean, and I'm not even brave enough to miss that many practices.
They both wanted the same thing, but they went about it a little bit different, where Coach Brown was this regimented coach. He was into fundamentals and practicing every day and working really hard, where Allen was this freak of nature.
McKee took it away, frees up Allen for the show.
I think they were just so competitive, and at times in the heat of the battle, they would say things or do things and it would frustrate each other.
I was relentless in trying to get him to do the very best in every area of his life, and it was hard for him.
When I got there, I think they had a mutual respect for each other. You know, Coach Brown knew what Allen was about, and that when the lights came on, he was gonna play harder than anyone else. And Coach Brown understood that, you know, Allen was a unique talent.
It's like a marriage. You know, you have your ups and downs, but you find that common ground to really make it work.
In the end, you know, it forged an unbelievable partnership that helped lead the Sixers to the NBA Finals in a great run in the history of the franchise.
Kobe, you talked about Allen Iverson. He was the toughest person you've ever played.
He was the most competitive player I faced, no question.
What? Really?
Oh, my God, he was relentless. He'd attack from the beginning of the game to the end of the game. And it's a player that I always had to pay attention to, so he always had me on my toes. And there's not another player that did that. He kept coming.
Unbelievable shot by Allen Iverson.
Allen Iverson right down the pipe.
Because Iverson is feeling it now. But you are helpless when AI has it going on.
We start the season off 10-0, and we have a great season. Great season. Bubba Chuck is phenomenal. Going to practice. He was doing everything he had to do in Larry Brown's world.
It's just important for you to just, you know, hold your own, man. Just work hard on everything, you know, that you want out of life. If it's basketball or anything else, you know, just work hard at it and, you know, hopefully something good will come out.
Not a lot of people win that MVP. That's when you're the best.
In the world.
Of the best of the best.
In the world.
Talk about that special feeling, being named MVP of the league in 2001.
It was a tribute to everybody that helped me accomplish that. You know what I mean? My girl, my kids, my family, my friends, my teammates, my coaches, the training staff, everybody that helped me accomplish that, they deserve praise too, man.
Not only are we in the playoffs our third year, my year, Allen's third year, then the fourth year, and we get eliminated the second round, both times, but an ugly team in yellow, Indiana Pacers. And now it's the fifth year, not only do we beat Indiana the first round.
A sleight of hand by Allen, goes behind the back, and hits!
You know, once he figured us out, you know, it was like you would think you would have him contained, and then you would look at the box score and he'd have 30 points.
This is one of my most memorable, did I say that right? How you say it? Memorable, whatever, man. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I'm gonna remember this game.
Then Toronto at 7.
Iverson for the lead, yes! 52 points for Iverson!
And then Milwaukee in 7.
Allen Iverson exploding here in game 7.
The 76ers are the Eastern Conference champions, and they're going to Tinseltown.
Damn right, baby. G-Town, I love you, man.
1, 2, 3.
Now we're going to Hollywood. It was proof positive that Allen Iverson is and can create dreams that come true.
Y'all got to the finals.
Yeah.
Talk about that team when you started looking on paper. People didn't understand. There were not a lot of big names.
So what?
Yourself, Dikembe. Talk about
all
what
right, that's a name.
That's enough, huh?
Yeah, that's...
But talk about what you guys accomplished with that group. We get to the finals.
I was the killer. And they took up for all my weaknesses. Defensively, obviously.
When you talk about leadership on the court, I think AI was right up there. He knew his place. Yes, did he take risk and go for the steal as opposed to the Michael Jordan-esque defense? But then he had guys like Aaron McKee and Eric Snow and George Lynch, who were defensive mavericks. They knew what Allen did. Let him do it.
Yeah, I could play the passing lane.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I could lead the league in steals every mm-hmm. year, whatever. Mm-hmm. But I want no good defensive player on the ball. You know what I mean?
why are you smiling?
They know it. My teammates know it. You know what I mean? But all of that I couldn't do, they made up for that. And all of that they couldn't do, I made up for it. So that's what made us a great team. That's what made Billy King a great general manager, because he put the people around me for us collectively to be successful.
You know, it was like the perfect storm. It was the perfect group of guys who could play with a talent like Allen.
He was the guy. He was the guy. If we played, you know, 4 games and 5 nights, he always had energy. And that's the one thing about him. He was our rabbit. And he came out, and he knew he was the headliner, and he embraced it, and he loved it. And we just followed his lead.
You look at what he had to work with, and you look at how far he got. You know, I think you can almost narrow it down to one game. You know, that first game against the Lakers in the finals. And here you have a team that was the literal juggernaut. I mean, they beat everybody. They hadn't lost a game in the playoffs.
Let's get dirty. Let's get dirty.
We knew what we were up against. We were up against the Lakers. We were up against Shaquille. We was up against Kobe, and, you know, the best team in the league.
That first game was certainly a defining moment for Iverson and the Sixers.
Iverson against Tyronn Lue. Baseline right, he backs up, he fires, 2 ball. Got it again! He's way too good! He steps around Lue and drilled it!
He's just too good.
You know, I played good defense. He went to shoot the basketball. I contested it, and then when I turned around and looked, I kind of stepped backwards and I fell down, and he stepped over me, and they made a big deal out of it. But, you know, just having a chance and opportunity to guard one of the NBA's greats was a big thing for me.
Here's Allen Iverson, little 6-foot Allen Iverson, 5'10", bringing his team to L.A., and they beat the Lakers in L.A., in game one of the finals.
Sixers shocked the world with a game one victory here over the world champion Los Angeles Lakers.
And at the end, you know, we all excited, jumping around, and we happy to win game one. And he just kind of looked me in the eyes and grabbed me and said, man, we're going to win this series. Calm down.
We ain't do that yet. We got a long way to go. We got a long way to go.
Iverson was incredible in that game. You know what I mean? He put the Sixers into that position. They shocked the Lakers. But then L.A. responded.
Time has run out on the 76ers. And that'll do it. Back-to-back titles for the Los Angeles Lakers.
In his mind, he felt like we had enough to be able to beat those guys.
I truly believe we would have beaten the Lakers if we'd have been healthy. But you don't get to the finals. You don't get to play against the team as great as the Lakers unless you have a great player like Allen Iverson. He made everybody around him better.
Who is the number one inspirational figure in your life to get you to this stage, nominated for the Hall of Fame?
I would say my mom, you know, for having me. Thank you.
Let's look all the way back. Young AI, who got you into the game of basketball? From a grassroots level.
You know what?
I hated basketball.
Wait a minute. AI hated basketball?
Yeah. Like, I thought it was soft. You know what I mean? I was always a football player. And one day, my mom said, you going to basketball practice. And I was like, I'm playing basketball. You know, basketball is soft. You know what I mean? And I mean, it took everything to get me out of that crib.
Allen was probably one of the best football players that I've ever seen play.
Iverson is just so quick that he will score.
The dream was to someday win the Heisman Trophy, win a national championship, and possibly get a chance to play in the NFL. It was never about basketball.
I thank my mom, man. If she didn't tell me that I was going to basketball practice that day, I would never play.
Why did she say basketball, yeah? Why? You know what I mean? What was her reasoning of saying you playing basketball?
I don't know. It might have been that season and getting me out of the house and to do something positive.
He actually played in the Boo Williams AAU program. I told Boo, I said, Boo, it's going to be a time where he's going to have to, you know, stop playing this basketball because you got to get ready for the NFL. And Boo looked me in the eye and he said, Mo, I'm gonna tell you something. This kid has a future in basketball. I used to instill in him, you know, you have such a love for sports, you have such a love for the game. If your dream is to someday play professionally, you're gonna have to get this education thing in place because it was a great imbalance. This guy hated school. This guy did not want to go to school, man.
You know, you talk about guys who grew up in rough environments or poor environments. I mean, you know, Iverson ticked every one of those boxes. He had a teenage mom. He grew up in a horribly poor area of Virginia, you know, like he had to fight back against that just to become the athlete he was in basketball and football.
The chances of him not being able to succeed and falling through the cracks were becoming more and more greater as the years and the days went on.
His senior year, he gets arrested in this bowling alley incident that's been, you know, talked about a lot. You know, gets indicted on like an anti-lynching statute. You know, so something completely backwards.
You know, he goes to a bowling alley with a bunch of people and a fight breaks out and he's the one guy out of everybody that gets sent to jail.
You know, all these schools that were pursuing him basically drop out. And Georgetown remains the one, and John Thompson remains the guy to say, like, hey, you know, I'm still behind you.
Allen was with me at Georgetown. The whole time he was at Georgetown, not one time did he ever come to me and mention his incarceration and say that those people had done him wrong, and they did.
Georgetown. Where did Georgetown, and why Georgetown over the others?
They gave me a chance. You know what I mean? Like, I had the greatest coach in the world. You know what I mean? The greatest inspiration for me was that guy. Like, he cared about me. It wasn't just about basketball, you know what I mean? Like, he cared about me as a person, and he saved my life, you know what I mean? Because I had no options. You know, I was recruited by everybody in the whole country. Mm-hmm. And then once the incident happened, it was over. You know, nobody, no more letters, no more nothing. You know what I mean? And my mom went out there and pleaded to him and asked him to save my life, and that's what he did.
I can't tell you most of the things she said to me, other than the fact that she said it emotionally and with a lot of compassion and love for him. But the one thing that she said to me that hit home was that if you don't take my son, they'll kill him.
What was about John Thompson? How he prepared you as a man?
Listen, my name was
To him, my name was MF. You know what I mean? Like, it was tough love, man. But it was real. It was so real. You know what I mean? Like, he cared about us. You know what I mean? It's not just, you know, it go far and beyond basketball. You know, he cares so much about his players and care about our lives after basketball. And he was so monumental and so great to me in my life, because I think about when I'm ready to make a mistake, I think about what he would say. You know what I mean? When I'm in the process of doing that, you know what I mean? So he was way more than a coach. He taught me how to play, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? On that level, he taught me how to play, but he prepared me for being a man.
The biggest thing that I had to make my mind up to is that he had just come out of prison and been incarcerated. In order to take Allen, it wasn't just the perception of his going to prison, it's his style of play. I had to realize that I couldn't incarcerate him also. And I had to make some adjustments because of his talent.
young fella, you've got to watch him. He's got very good foot speed. You see, that's Allen Iverson trying to go up and get it.
He's the toughest guy, pound for pound, that I've ever seen play basketball. He had a heart bigger than his body.
Did he take advantage of it? Yes, he took advantage of it and became one of the best damn players to ever play in that league. And I feel honored that I...
Crowds, that's what we needed here in Philadelphia. That's what I know I needed to turn this franchise around.
Georgetown, my family and friends, along with Coach Thompson and Miss Fellin, then I think I can go a long way. I think I can be successful.
You got enough patches there?
Nah, not enough. I want to keep adding them on.
What's the best memory out of all those right
now? Probably my first one. And the one in D.C. when we were down big, came back. But I mean, all of them great.
Obviously, everybody know why we're here. I'm formally announcing my retirement from basketball, and it was a great ride.
I think the toughest thing about trying to decide when to retire is guys who can't play are kicking your butt. Because you have to understand something, sports are a young man's game. And no matter how much talent you have, it ends for everybody.
I'm sure it was very difficult for him to walk away. But at the same time, he's one of the few who can say they left it all on the court.
Talk about retirement. Retirement from the game that... That was tough. That's tough for all of us.
No, it's not.
Wasn't tough? No, wait a minute. Be honest.
Okay, I thought it was the worst. But then, in the aftermath of it, when you can be around your kids and your girl 24/7, you ain't got to worry about leaving for weeks at a time. There's no excuse. You there. You can be there all the time. And, like, that's the greatest part about it.
You wasn't supposed to retire. Selfishly, I wanted to see AI still playing. Take away everything else, just playing a game of basketball.
I was ready. Like, when I did it, I knew it was time. Like, I was tired, bruh. Like, I was tired, man. I was tired of all of, you know, the misunderstanding, people perceiving me to be something that I'm not. Overall, I
I was able to have thick skin. After, you know, going through so many things, I was able to be like, all right, well, everybody don't love you, bro.
But I'm talking about in between them lines. Take all that away.
Yeah, you take all that away. Well, in between them games. I miss basketball. I miss playing. I want to play.
That's what I want to hear.
Yeah.
I want to see the smile. Because yeah, you see the difference, though, the smile when I start talking about basketball.
Yeah, I want to play. I want to play. I want to have fun. I love I love the thrill of exciting my fans.
How about a big round of applause? Hall of Famer, a 6-foot guard from Georgetown, number 3, Allen Iverson.
You know, I think you could almost put him in the Hall of Fame alone off his impact culturally.
He changed pop culture. Allen changed basketball. There's only very few people that can lay claim of changing the sport. Jordan was one, Chamberlain was another one, Allen was another one.
At first, everybody looked at him as like, oh, this guy's a thug just by tattoos, cornrows, but it wasn't about that. You know, it was about him being who he was.
And that's what made Allen a rock star. It brought a whole new audience to the organization, and they can't deny that.
His cultural impact went a bunch of ways. I mean, you could look at the dress code the NBA put in, and you could sort of call that the Allen Iverson rule. He definitely did not like to dress up.
In my opinion, a lot of people's opinion, you were a cultural icon. What's your thoughts about that?
I am. I know it. Mm-hmm. And I took the ass whipping from it. Mm-hmm. For guys to be comfortable in their skin, for guys to live like they live and obviously dress like they dress.
We're all enamored by folks who stands up against the establishment and says, this is me and this is what I want to do. And this is how I feel. And this is how I want to represent the game.
When I die, if I'm fortunate enough to come back in the next lifetime, I want to be AI, man. You know what I mean? I want to be me. I'm satisfied with who I am. And I just want dudes to feel good about, you know, being them, bro. Like, it ain't nothing wrong with it.
Who reminds you of AI, though? Is it Russell?
Nobody. He remind me of me.
He's not AI, but he reminds me of attacks.
Yeah, because what's in his chest? He relentless. He play with heart. You know what I mean? He play every game like it's his last. I just love watching him play. But Steph is just, you know, hey. We never seen nothing like it. But it's another little dude, a little guy, 10, 15 years old, that's gonna come along, and we gonna be saying the same thing. I ain't never seen nothing like this.
Right.
To me, in my eyes, Mike is the greatest to ever do it. But then, heck I'm Kobe, heck I'm LeBron, heck I'm Melo, you know what I mean? Heck I'm Durant. Those dudes are watching the dudes before them. You know what I mean? So, it's gonna be, I don't want it to be another Allen Iverson. I want it to be the best. Whoever that is, you know what I mean? I want it to be somebody better than Allen Iverson. Like, that's what makes it exciting for us. That's what makes our game so great. You know what I mean? Because it's going to continue to evolve.
He's a lot different than everybody else that's been inducted. And for the younger generation, it's kind of like you stick your chest out because it's like, all right, you know what? A guy that just didn't buy into what everybody else said and did it the way he wanted to do it, he still was able to be selected into the Hall of Fame.
Let me see if I'm dreaming. Let me see if I'm dreaming.
As I always said to him, you're the author of your story. You get to have the last say. So he never concerned himself about what people thought about him. Only thing that mattered to him was the people that loved him and the people that was in the circle.
They wanted me to talk about how much y'all love me, but
Trust me and know that the feeling is mutual. You know, just sitting here in this moment, I'm saying to myself, you know, damn, you know, Dr. J, Charles Barkley, Moses Malone, Mo Cheeks, Bobby Jones, are you serious? You know, my name can be mentioned with those names. Y'all have to show me the fool that says dreams don't come true. 'Cause they do. I love you, Philadelphia. I love y'all for accepting me and let me be me, let me make my mistakes, let me be human, let me learn from them. Just embracing me and making this my home forever.
I want my legacy to just be the guy that came out and gave everything he had, the whole 165 pounds, 6 foot frame, everything he had. I'm up here getting emotional with you guys from this. So imagine what it's gonna be when that day come. Like,